So how are you guys? We got Nathan Cross, a new builder in town. He's been here for about 2 years now, or 3 years now. Came down from Orlando. I think the traffic was too heavy. You spent too much time driving from one job site to another. Nora Johnson of Michael Saunders & Company, Kim Ogilvy of Michael Saunders & Company, and the guy who builds the houses so that Nora and Kim can sell them, Josh Wynn. So Kim and Nora, what percentage of buyers would you say want an architect-designed house? Kim, take it first.
I would say my percentage is probably about 25%. You know, people who want architect-designed homes, of course, there's quite a demand for that. But I would say the general Joe and Mary buying public, you know, it's still more of about a 75% balance. I don't know what Nora thinks.
So they're happy with a builder-designed house,
yeah, exactly,
or a resale.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nora, how about you? What do you find?
I would say that most of my clients that end up wanting to have an architecturally built home want to do it themselves. So we work on finding a lot and then the architect and a builder. But I don't have that many that come to me and say specifically, let's find an architecturally built home.
Okay. Do you think architect designed houses have a special value in the market?
I do. I have a recent example, actually. One of my service areas is Harbor Acres, and I sold a garden lot there with a home about 4,000 square feet last year, and lot and home package was about 513 a square foot. The next door house right now is pending that Tatiana White designed at 713 a foot. So that's quite a disparity. I'm not saying it's like that in all cases, but this is just a prime example of really great architecture. Of course, it's newer. I mean, new is the biggest trend there is. And so they're going to have some value there, but that's a pretty significant difference.
Go ahead.
I also think we're storytellers. You know, when we have buyers or we're representing a seller, we're really in a position where they want to hear the entire story. They want all the details. It's sort of the Chip and Joanna HGTV, you know, phenomenon. Every detail matters. And I think when an architect has been involved, it shows a lot more forethought. And that detail does hold a lot of value.
Mm-hmm. Nathan, is the architect often part of the projects that you do? Do you do a lot of projects with architects?
Yes, absolutely. But like a builder, one architect isn't like the rest. So just keep that in mind. So, you know, this was an interesting topic. So the answer to the topic is yes and no. So I've seen architects build a box on a box and then hired a builder who used substandard building materials and practices and, you know, just turned out to be a bad project all from get-go, from concept to design. And then I've seen masterpieces designed and followed through with the building aspect of it. So like a builder, just because a builder has a GC license doesn't necessarily make them qualified to do what you want them to do. And very much the same with architecture. Just because they're an architect doesn't mean it's qualified. So whether you're picking your builder or you're picking your architect or your real estate agent, do your due diligence. Make sure that it's right for you. It's what you want. And that it's a team process, so can the team execute it?
Josh, is it a case where if you hire an architect, you want to make sure you hire a builder who can faithfully carry out that plan at a high quality level? You don't want to have a big bunch of design and a low level of construction.
Yeah, definitely. In my opinion, you don't really hire an architect in a vacuum. Really what you want to hire is your design build team. As a collaborative team. So you want somebody that can work together to see your vision through. So an architect, an interior designer, even the engineers, they all need to be able to work together with your builder to see the project through to completion. So it doesn't really happen in a vacuum. Most people that come to me actually come to me before they hire an architect, and they actually want somebody that will help them find the right architect for their needs, for their project. And I'll put several of the guys that are here actually in front of them more often than not. And they'll select their architect and we all work together to get the project done. So.
Kim, have you found yourself in the position of putting together such a team? Do you have clients come to you and say, I wanted to build a dream home. How do we make it happen?
Absolutely. That is oftentimes the case and most of the time I agree with Josh, they will choose the builder first. But you know, we have our top three in every category that are our go-to builders and architects. And so we know the quality and we know the vision and we know that what they can produce, you know, there's architecture and then there's architecture. So, but yeah, we're very used to assembling teams to complete projects for sure.
Nora, tell me about the equation for deciding whether a lot is good for your client to purchase with the idea of hiring an architect and building a dream home. It starts with the land, does it not?
Oftentimes it does. I mean, you can exhaust a search and recognize that what they're looking for doesn't exist, which then takes you to the land, which takes you to the neighborhoods that, you know, are of interest. And, you know, just echoing what Kim and Josh have said, it's then assembling a team because, you know, the builder wants to look at it, but then the architect has, you know, insights and the 50% rule playing in, and if you're doing a renovation. So the team is very important.
Yeah. Kim, Don Saba couldn't be here today, but he always talks about that equation of at what point does a lot become a teardown. Josh is nodding his head there, too. And Nathan, I'm going to bring you this in with you, too, with your Orlando experience, so just hold tight. Josh, what are you seeing in terms of what makes a house a teardown?
Honestly, that decision is usually made before my involvement. Usually they're working with a realtor and or an appraiser in the selection of the land. But, you know, it's fairly intuitive. It, you know, cases like Mr. Vinnick's house, that might be an exception. The owner of the Lightning bought a really nice home, actually two of them on the bay, and tore them both down to build a giant house. That's the exception to the rule, I'd say. It's usually fairly obvious. It's usually a home, especially if it's waterfront, that does not meet the FEMA standard. Usually it cannot be reasonably updated to meet the client's new expectations within the FEMA 50% rule standard. And that's usually the driving force. Most of the homes that I'm building are waterfront, but not all. And most of them do not comply with Florida or the FEMA 50% rule standard for floodplain management.
Do you find yourself driving down the street in Lido Shores or Bird Key or something and looking at a house and saying to yourself, I can't wait till they tear that one down because I really want to build something fabulous on that lot?
There's definitely a few of those, and then there's also those that I drive by and say, I'm so glad that hasn't been torn down, and I hope no one ever tears it down, because there's a lot of great architecture, historic architecture that has community value that still exists and does not meet sort of that litmus test for maybe the cost value for the land, and that I really hope people will keep just because of the inherent value that it has for the community.
Yeah, there's a lot of those along Bayshore Road where there's vintage houses right on the bay. They're on grade, but they're gems, and they tend to be from the 20s and 30s, and you don't want to get rid of them. In Orlando, you've got these lakes all over the place, and that's probably the toughest thing I find about visiting Orlando is I think I know where I'm going, and then I run into a lake. So is the teardown trend, was it when you were in Orlando, was that a big thing up there?
Yeah, I say probably 20% of jobs we did were teardowns.
On lakefront property?
On lakefront property. So a lot of the, so the interesting thing about that market is we would have a lot that was worth $2 million on a lake. So the property value difference really isn't much. You know, here we're building on a different kind of water. Mm-hmm. In Orlando, some of the pristine lakes were, you know, half acre lake lot was $2 million. So a lot of them were fish camps. So 50, 60, 70, 80 years ago, they were a fish camp, and they were a retreat for guys from up north to come down and hang out with their buddies and smoke cigars at night and fish during the day. And so we ended up, you know, getting rid of some of those, rightfully so. You know, they weren't anything.
Well, it was
special.
An easy equation. I mean, you had 99% of your value was in the lot.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Kim, what's the equation now? At what point do you start thinking a house that somebody comes to you and said, we've lived in this house for 40 years and we updated it about 20 years ago. We put in a new kitchen, got some new flooring about 15 years ago. We probably should do the windows. You know, it's in Harbor Acres, it's overlooking the bay. Where do the numbers fall?
It's a tough evaluation. I mean, and it's, each case is independent, and you know how that floor plan can be manipulated to work for their needs, at what cost. And then another large factor now is the timing. With the 50% rule, bringing the appraiser back into the property, examining the new evaluation, and then continuing. So it's not only financially a motivated decision, but it's the timing. And people, you know, like to see things be in a home sooner than later. So
they don't want to take the 2 years it might take for permitting and design and construction.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say more often times than not, I'm finding that people are unable to do the remodel. They end up eventually going into a new construction situation.
Mm-hmm. Kim, it's interesting. You can see a house on Siesta Drive in Southgate, east of the trail. Almost all of those big sprawling ranch houses there have been redone. I don't know, Josh, if you've done any of those projects, but yeah. But you take that same house and put it in Bird Key and it's probably a teardown.
Absolutely. There's such a disparity in land value. I mean, anytime you get closer to the water, the land value is going to go up substantially. So, you know, my cautionary tale is that if you've got an older home on grade, there are going to be buyers for that. There definitely are. But don't go plowing a lot of dollars into that. You'll never see them back out. You know, you enjoy living in it the way it is. You can appreciate the art and the architecture and your views, but you're just gonna be throwing good money after bad. So, you know, kind of back to, I think Don Seba's magic formula is like 30%, you know, 30, 30, and 30. If your land value, you know, is greater than 30%, you know, especially some of these waterfront properties, I mean, they're 50 or 70% is all land value. So, of course, you know, that is an obvious teardown. But there is a formula that we tend to go by.
Yeah, the really tough one is that $2 million house where the house is worth $1 million and the lot's worth $1 million. And then
we call those in the cracks. You know, you're not one thing, you're not the other thing.
Yeah,
you're just
yeah.
In the crack.
20 years ago, almost 20 years ago, the big house was built on Westway by Sandcastles of Sarasota. It sold with the lot next door for 13.2. As a matter of fact, I think you sold that.
I think I did.
I think you did sell
that. That was our first interview.
Exactly, that was our first interview. And back then, the developer of that property, Phil Shimoleski, told me only about 1 out of 20 buyers wants a modernist house, an architect-designed modernist house. That was around 2002 or so. Now it seems like at least half, and Josh, you probably know this, at least half of the new houses west of the trail are modernist architect-designed houses. What happened? What changed that trend? How'd that trend happen? Nathan, you seem to want to answer this question.
Sure.
Even though you're new to town.
Well, so you always do your research when you move someplace, Harold.
Yeah.
especially doing what I do for
good
a living.
For you, yeah.
So what I've noticed the trend here is a lot of it's land value. So you have most of your high dollar individuals living in Miami, West Palm Beach area. You know, now some of the property over there is $3, 4, 5 million for a lot. So we're starting to see the shift in tide. We're starting to see some of that money roll this way. And there's other factors. Sarasota's done a really good job of maintaining its charm. You know, we don't have high rises on our keys. We don't have high rises on our land or our islands. We have
mid rises,
yeah. 6 stories mm-hmm. or less. So you're able to keep that charm. You're able to keep the traffic down on the islands, which you know. People that want to spend $10 million, $5 million, $2 million, they don't want to be in gridlock. They don't want to be stuck someplace trying to get to dinner, waiting an hour in traffic. So there's a lot of multiples in that, but a big one that has started the shift was the price in land. I think as our price continues to go up, you know, eventually we'll hit that shelf. Fortunately for this area, we do a great job giving people reasons to live here. you know, the arts, the culture, the food, the things to do. So we're starting to be more like the East Coast, the Southeast Coast of Florida, I think, but keeping some of the tourism maybe out of it, keeping some of the with that comes with the high rises out of it, and kind of keeping towards that luxury feel.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we're talking high rises in Miami. We're talking 40 to 60 stories. It's a lot different than our 18s. Nora, why more contemporary modernist houses and fewer med revs than we saw 20 years ago?
I think it's the people are looking for a more informal lifestyle. They like the wide open floor plan. They like the connection with the outdoors, in which you have more glass, which is, you know, has more to do with contemporary than it would a traditional home. And I'd like to think that it's a little bit of a nod back to what was here, you know, in the Sarasota Architectural School, you know, so.
I agree. I think it's a cultural thing. The reality is that Sarasota is a known artist and architectural destination. We have a modernist pedigree of architecture here that pretty much rivals anywhere else in the country. And I think we have a smarter resident, really, and somebody that's really embracing sort of a newer way to live and not kind of stuck in trying to recreate the things that have been happening in architecture for 2,000 years. You're really trying to grab hold of the Florida lifestyle. Nobody really did that better than Paul Rudolph and Twitchell and these guys that really made a house that lives with the environment. They're vernacularly based. They're architecture that is really rooted in Florida cracker architecture, which is our only real vernacular. It's not med rev.
Right.
And so it lives better. Frankly, it just lives better. It's more efficient. You can live closer to the land, and that's why people live here. And I think it's really that simple.
I personally see a younger, wealthier crowd coming to town. And if you're just retired with $300 million in the bank or more, you don't want to come down to build a house that's just like everybody else's. You want to make a statement, and you're probably going to find that by hiring an architect and a quality builder.
There's no rules in modernism, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're not confined to, you know, a certain style of arch or a certain rhythm of cornice or, you know, a certain order of column. So there's really no rules. Defining modernism is difficult.
Yeah, it's very.
There's a wide variety.
It's a big language. Yeah. How about the cost to build a modern house compared to one that has baseboards and crown molding and a lot
it's
of applique? Yeah. Talk about that.
It is not less because you see less. It is not easier because you see less. It's a more difficult house to build. It's definitely more finite. It's fussier. It's a fussy house. We don't get to cover mistakes or ill considerations with a crown mold, and you can't hide a reveal with a fat casing. Everything matters. These houses, my clients are mostly hiring me to build modern homes, and my clients are a lot surgeons and forensic accountants and particular people that have a very sort of perfectionist nature to them, and they want to see precision the same way that they may buy a Ferrari or a Lamborghini. They want to see those clean lines, and they don't want to see it cluttered. And so it's more expensive to build that.
So that plastic surgeon you're building for, he wants a clean line on that face, and he wants a clean line at that where that wall meets the floor. He doesn't want to cover it over with a big clumsy Band-Aid.
Indeed.
Yeah.
So Sarasota's... What I get asked a lot, and it's probably my least favorite question, probably your least favorite question, and everybody participating here, is what's a square foot price? There is no such thing in what we do. So if you want to go down a liquid ranch, you can get a square foot price all day long. That's, you know, if that's what you're looking for, then that's your market. What we do, everything is different. Everything is one of a kind. Everything that we do is a prototype. It's never been done before. So we're not building something that, oh yeah, I've done 25 of these. We're building something that has never been done before. Every time we get a blueprint, every time we build something, this may have never been done before. So we push the limits. We push the limits on architecture, on building. We push the limits on building material, on engineering. So to build something great. So for us, I mean, we're very much a building company. We get a set of blueprints. We will give you a price. Our price might be $2,149,063. And that 63 cents is important because we took the time to dissect that plan and actually bid it. So that's the big difference on what we do. You know, it's one of a kind, unique, never been done building.
Right. Kim?
Yeah, unfortunately, the language of the buyers that we're working with, their brains are all about dollar per square foot, and I totally 100% agree with you. So our job is to educate those buyers and the differences of quality of construction, cost of land, you know, all the engineering, the architecture, the amount of glass that goes into that modern structure versus the baseboards is significantly different. So, you know, you're right, it's all apples and oranges, but that's really a big, it's a tough job for us to do that.
Kim, the last question for you and Nora is, if you have side-by-side houses, both facing the same, exactly the same direction, side-by-side lots, similar square footage, say it's exactly the same square footage, what will sell for more, a Mediterranean Revival house that's the same age or a modern house that's the same age?
Oh, absolutely. You know, markets change, trends change. Right now, all day long, 9 out of 10 is going to be modern.
Nora?
Agreed, modern.
Yeah. Okay, great. Who's got a question? Yes, sir.
I wonder how much of the market how much of the market understands the difference between contemporary and modern, and how do you educate them about that? Because from my perspective, there are a lot of builder contemporaries that lack quality and both construction and design, whereas hopefully moderns are something totally different, but your clients don't necessarily understand that, I don't think, right?
Anybody want to take that? It might be a better question for an architect coming up.
So the question really is, do buyers understand the difference between contemporary architecture and modern architecture? Is that what I'm understanding?
Yeah, how do you help educate them about that so they appreciate?
Because a Mediterranean Revival house that's built today is technically contemporary.
Yeah, it's...
But it's not in spirit.
You know, I think more and more clients aren't interested in answering that question. That's my experience. They're more interested, they're not even interested in understanding the answer to that question, and they don't even want to ask that question. The reality is because they don't want, most of my clients don't want to identify their home as a particular style. They really don't care if it's contemporary or modern, but in general, they will suggest that they either prefer a modern home, which they would define as white and boxy, typically. I hate that, but that's the reality. And they would call a contemporary home something that does not look like a more historic piece of architecture, something that you could not define as Mediterranean Revival or as Gothic or as colonial, but is built today. It doesn't necessarily fit into what they would consider to be modern. And that's the typical understanding. But most people are looking to kind of bridge the gap between them and find sort of a warm modern, something that is not as sterile and not as white and crisp as most traditional modern houses. I hate to use the word traditional modern.
Yeah.
Does that even make
well,
sense?
We've got the mid-century modern houses.
Indeed.
But then we have what I call the millennial modern houses.
International style.
Which are quite different from the neo-moderns that you see in architectural magazines. You know, they tend to be these grand performance spaces like Frank Gehry would build, or Herzog and de Meuron are building neo-modern buildings. We just don't do those here. We kind of have taken the Sarasota school and beefed it up for the codes of today.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So for me, modern's very clean, simple, straight lines. You know, it doesn't really matter what style of home we're building. Clean, simple, straight lines. Contemporary is kind of something we don't really hear a lot of anymore. It's almost like contemporaries become more retro now than anything. But when you start throwing your curves, your round columns, things of that nature into it, I think you start hitting that more contemporary feel.
Yeah,
personally.
Certainly. If you, my research today dictates that the word contemporary is being used to describe the 21st century cutting edge, computer driven architecture that you tend to see on television commercials for fancy cars. I just saw one yesterday. It was obviously filmed in Miami. And there was another one where they were kayaking through Vancouver and showing off the cityscape of Vancouver. And you saw a lot of new buildings that were obviously cutting-edge design buildings that you wouldn't describe as like the Lever House or the Seagram Building of the mid-century of the 1950s. So completely different language, a different accent on the same language. Yeah. Okay, one more question, sir.
When you design a home for a specific person, for their specific desires, let's say, and then it comes time to sell, how does that added investment come back and be proven later dollars?
Kim, Nora?
I think, again, it's a well-designed home. You know, there's architects and then there's architects. I mean, I think that if you're building an homage to yourself or it's form over function, then, you know, there's going to be some difficulty. The buyer pool will be narrowed to that particular taste. Whereas, you know, if you have a vision whereby the function comes first and it's on a beautiful sided lot and it makes sense and you have a fantastic builder, you know, I think that you'll be rewarded for that, but I just think you have to carefully approach that, narrowing the buyer band in the end.
I was surprised. I looked up, and there are 7 listings that we have over 10 million, and from 10 million to 18 million, and only one of those listings mentions an architect. I thought that was very interesting, and I think, you know, we have such talent in this town that we do need to bridge that gap. We need to bring the collaborative efforts that we've all discussed on this panel together, because I think you have a really unique opportunity to do something quite wonderful, but I was quite surprised at how seldom it was mentioned.
That's what,
and it was Guy Peterson
for.
I thought I might mention.
Yeah, the 18 million, the Aquadesia. Yeah, which is now 15.
Yeah,
15 million.
So just to piggyback on that, if we're talking to a client about building something, you know, there's certain stages that we like to ask. Or is this a forever home? Is this something that you want to be dragged out of at the end of the day? Is this something that you're going to sell in 5 years? So these are important questions to ask. If your budget allows it and you have the means to do it, then let's just do what you want to do. Statistically speaking, every 20 years, somebody puts in the same amount of value that they originally paid for an average house in America. So if you're going to live there for more than 20 years, it doesn't matter. Because whoever buys it after that 20 years is going to put that amount of money into that house to update it or to get it ready. So 10 to 20 years is kind of that tipping factor. If you know you're going to be there at least 10 years, more than 20 years, then let's just look at what you're comfortable spending, because the rest of it, resale, doesn't really matter, because whoever buys it, they're going to be tearing it down or they're going to be hiring a remodeler to come in and completely gut it and do something new.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, we have a number of mansions on the market that are over 20 years old, and boy, are they hard to sell, aren't they? Kim, what's the timeline for these new homes? At what point do the people who build the new homes that they hired Jerry to design them and Josh to build them, how long do they keep them before they resell them so that they can resell them?
Well, fortunately in Sarasota, people really like to move around a lot. So
they good for you, huh?
May be into boating for 5 years and then they take up golf and then, you know, they want to live down south in the Oaks or they, you know, so Nora and I, of course, love that mentality. But, you know, on average, there is definitely a statistic. I think it's in Sarasota County, something like 5 years. I mean, it's really low,
yeah.
Above a certain price point. So these people are younger now. They're adventurous or, you know, they're moving into a different style of living, whether it be a retirement community, et cetera. But
I'm thinking of the house on Bayshore Road on 2.5 acres. I think it's now listed at about $8 million. It was built in 1987, and it's been on the market almost since 1987, seems like, you know, and it's 30 years old now, 31 years old. And just, even though it's been redone and it's beautiful, and the land is incredible. Just harder to sell those old mansions. Now, if it were 90 years, it might not be the case.
So just to comment on that, I think part of the reason why it's hard to sell is, you know, the good old saying, well, they don't build them like they used to. It's really not true. We're building things greater and better than it's ever been done in the history of mankind. So, and part of that is Florida building code, part of that's engineering, part of that's the architectures, part of that's the builders in this room. So the good old saying, they don't make them like they used to, does not apply to building. Might apply to your microwave oven, might apply to your TV, does not apply to building structures. So for what we can do for you today with an $8.7 million budget versus what was done in 1987, apples and oranges.
Mm-hmm. Kim,
I think probably the biggest disconnect, though, is the seller's expectations, because they're not factoring in the depreciation rate, you know, of what that house is no longer worth versus a new structure. So that land with a new structure on it, even built and designed the same size and the same way, people want new, and they're not factoring that in. So if you're priced properly and you're in a great location on the waterfront, there is absolutely no reason in this marketplace that you're not selling.
A realtor once told me sellers are the last ones to get it. I'm not sure exactly who that was. Her initials might have been K-O. How about a round of applause for this panel here? Nathan Cross, Nora Johnson, Kim Ogilvie, Josh Wynn. Thank you so much.